This is Hacking the Afterlife podcast. Hello, Jennifer.
Hi, Richard.
How are you?
I am actually doing very well, just a little bit on the tired side because I've had private events every single night this. I have one every single night this week.
Events? What? Tell us about them. What are you doing?
Last night I had a really cool event where I actually read a book club. So there's about 25 women that I read last night.
Wow.
And that was actually, it was a lot of fun because it was in Hermosa Beach. And I live in Manhattan Beach, so I knew a lot of them. And then I had my medium Monday, you know, which was sold out on Monday for another 20 people or so. And then I work on Tuesday, and then I worked yesterday, and I had a podcast that I did in Studio City that I didn't know who I was reading until I got there. Really cool. And then tomorrow I get to read a family at their house, which is
so you were doing another podcast beside our podcast?
I know I cheated on you, Richard.
It's all right. Not the same. It's good. It's all good. You know, it's just kind of funny. Here we are doing this podcast. How many years later? At least two, maybe three.
I know. How cool is that, though?
It is pretty cool. It is pretty cool. I got to say, I talk to people about our podcast, and then as I'm saying aloud, like, and this happened, I realize, oh my God, this is insane what I'm saying. They're not going to believe me, you know. We just have so much fun. All right. Well, I know I don't have you for a long time today, but let's.
How was your birthday week?
My birthday week was because of you.
No.
Fantastic. No, it really was. That really made the whole week. I don't know. I think, you know, after a couple of days, you're like, okay, what am I celebrating? I'm older. All right. Very good. So.
We're all older.
We're all older. And, you know, the weird part about this work is, the more we do it, the more it feels like you become aware of your other journeys here.
Yeah, that reminds me, I just got put something in my head. I was talking to my friend who passed away last week, Jill. And I'm like, Jill, what is it like there up there? Do I have security? And she showed me this huge, gigantic place. Because I'm like, is it crowded up there? Like, was it? I asked to see what the room looked like from the other side. And she said, she goes, think of like the highest tech, like the most incredible up-to-date software, basically. That is what secures your place because of how many people come in and how many people talk to you through you to there. So they protect you. Not that you need protection, but they protect you up there. It was just fascinating. It was a really cool, like, I don't know. I think everybody that opens up more has very similar things happen.
Yeah.
Like you feel like you don't have control over anything, but the more that you are connected to your higher self, the more that you are connected to your soul and your dharma, I feel like you have so much help up there. And that was something that was really interesting. Like, people do feel alone here, but when you start realizing how much help you have up there, you start doing more things that you like to do, and you start doing more things that help others. It's very interesting. Anyway, I thought it was, I'm like, wow, I never even thought of it like that. Like, the brighter your light is, the more security you have.
There's also this other aspect. I was talking about it with a friend yesterday, and we were just talking about the idea that, you know, while you're asleep, if you're having a dream, if you're aware of your dream, let's put it that
way. Right.
Dream can also be working stuff out and having adventures and doing. And as we've talked, the dreams have become kind of slightly different because you start to become aware that, okay, this is a dream. I'm having a.
I'm like, don't say he's gone. Don't say he's dead. I remember waking up.
Well, and then these people who show up in our dream, are they actors? Are they players? Are they appearing at our request? Or are we appearing in their dream? You know, so those questions come to light. And then I was just talking about how, you know, animals on the planet, look, cats sleep 18 hours. Now, how would nature come up with this idea that you would spend, you know, like the most of your life asleep? You would There's something going on while they're asleep. And the same goes for us. We sleep a third of our lives. It doesn't mean that nothing is happening. We assume it does because we're just not aware of the stuff. But once you start to really dig into what dreams are, what's happening, or people are showing up, you realize, oh, I'm having adventures all the time.
All the time. And you get some adventures that kind of give you a little bit about what's going to happen in your future here. Like my dad showing me, like having a talent show and then having that actually reading it in my mom's, will, her trust, saying that she wants a talent show at her funeral. Like he was showing
All
me, with my
right,
mom.
letting you know. Well, and speaking of talent shows, I think you and I, if you're available, I mean, they've invited me to come to this contact in the desert, which is going to be May 30th through June 3rd out in Desert Springs or wherever that is near Palm Springs. And I told them I'd love to see if Jennifer was available and we'd come out and do a live demonstration talking to people off stage. Who normally don't incarnate here. So,
Awesome.
meaning, we're gonna be talking to ETs if we can. We'll see. Maybe we'll talk to five. I don't know. It's whoever wants to come in.
I think I love the fact we have no control over it. And who knows? Somebody, like, I have the chills just thinking about it. Like, somebody, I'm sure. I mean, and Palm Desert is actually a very magical place. Like, there is something that goes on out there. There is
Golfing.
like a, oh, that too. But
<Okay.
yeah, if it was really that magical, my golf game would be a lot better, but it's not.
laughs> You're right. That's very good. Speaking of golf games, Luana.
But wait, what?
Oh.
And so you're also going to reference something new that's coming about as well, once you mentioned.
You mean the, well, a couple of things. One is I'm going to be on Coast to Coast next March 17th.
March 17th.
Dawn, whatever time,
No.
late at night, usually about 10 o'clock.
May 17th,
March 17th,
March.
next week, just in a few
No,
days.
today's the 21st. You can't be on the
All right,
17th.
6 days. Oh, did I say seven? I'm sorry. Thank you. 27. I'm
Don't
going
fight me on it. I'm like,
to
my daughter had St. Fratty's Day.
Oh,
Probably
very
slow.
good. Thank you. No, March 27th, I'm going to be on Coast to Coast
Okay.
talking about the new book, Close Encounters of the Flipside Kind, How to Phone Home. And there's quite a few excerpted interviews that we've done where we've talking to people on the flip side. It was funny, last week I mentioned that I'd been editing Five, the librarian in the Akashic Library, and his comment was, "Stop editing me."
I don't remember that.
Is
Really?
hilarious. Yeah, he said, "You're editing me too much." Like the guy, what am I supposed to do? Talk to the editor and say, "Look, the guy
Funny.
that was interviewing said that I got to put this back in." Anyways, it's fascinating. And then what else is going on? So the contact in the desert is in the May 30th. I'm getting the dates all screwed up through June 3rd. And
Next week I'll be gone. I'll be at Dr. Joe Dispenza's retreat weekend.
oh, retreat. I love that they call those retreats. It's like, the middle of the
It's
week.
not. But I love it. I get to get immersed in meditation, and I'm so excited to go.
Where is that going to be? And
San Diego.
so, can anybody sign up? Go down there, drive down.
As long as you've had a week long experience, or like the one that I had in Cancun. So it's for people that have already been through like the
I
training
see. Yeah, like
stuff.
the graduates. Okay. Yeah, that's very cool. And where can we find that online? Just
Just
curious.
drjoedispenza.com, I think.
Okay, very cool. All right. Does our friend Luana on the flip side have she got anybody she wants to bring into our class?
Yeah, she feels like she's wrangling somebody in, which is.
Wrestling?
Yeah, I just saw a buffalo. Hold on.
Buffalo. That's it.
Yeah, just give me a second.
Well, of course, that's a city and that's a person.
I know. I think it's more of the person, but
Okay. That's funny.
it's about you. And it's about something. I feel like I watched this movie too, or we've talked to him before.
So this is somebody associated with me that we've talked to before.
Almost feel like it's the Indian chief.
Oh, okay, Buffalo. Okay. Oh, yeah. Sitting Bull.
Thank you. Thank you.
You know, this is how Jennifer and I work. She sees something, I then supply context because I have a tendency to remember every conversation we've had.
Which I don't.
And you know, and thank goodness for I'm actually recording it so I can look back. But we did have a conversation with Sitting Bull. For those who are not familiar, Tatanka Watanka, who or no, Tatanka Io, I can't say it, but he, reference to the great Sioux warrior and chief. And what does he want to say?
He wants to talk about the planet.
Oh, please. Thank you.
Interesting. So it feels like he wants to talk about the planet and how, so we talk about aliens, we think of, things that come from the sky, and he's talking about different kinds of aliens that are, but it's dealing with the Earth realm. Like, so give me a second.
Is he showing if can you tell me what color buffalo that you're seeing?
He's not showing me a buffalo. Buffalo is just to get to
Just to get to this conversation.
Sitting Bull. And so Sitting Bull is explaining how there's a lot of different energies that live with among us that can't be seen, that are also that are living within the planet, just a different.
Okay. And he's referring to not just the Sioux world view, which was, you know,
I don't know what that view is.
religious thing, yeah, whatever, you know, that everything is imbued with spirit, but he's
Right.
also referring to something he's observing now that that is correct.
I keep saying that, yeah.
You tapped your nose to say that's correct. So he's talking about how everything, trees, rocks, water, all imbued with consciousness or spirit, let's say, and how when we think to ourselves, that you know, these are all separate from us, that they're all we're all connected to these things. Is that something like that? Tatanka Iotake. Sorry, that's how he's known.
He gave me the chills so bad. I'm like, I have to
I
put
saw
makeup
that. Jennifer suddenly went ice. And
on.
what so what is that what you want to say, sir? You want to talk about nature and our relation to it?
Yeah, if we knew that everything has a spirit, even like they showed me this. What I'm looking at, like the desk that's in our office was made out of, from a tree. And like that still has the spirit that's within it. Like everything, even though we think of it as being gone or dead or whatever, everything he's showing me has come from, even dealing with plastic and where things have come from.
Because and if I may, they're atoms agreeing to hold space. It's almost like, is that correct?
That's what,
Absolutely.
yeah.
Okay. But that idea that, you know, we look at an object, we hold it up and we say, well, what is that? And we have an association perhaps with who used to own it. Like when we talked to him once before, he mentioned that the Autry Museum in Los Angeles had one of his pipes that he, like a smoking pipe, and I had seen it there. And I actually called the curator and mentioned to him, because I saw that it was no longer in circulation. And he had mentioned that. He had said they've taken it out of circulation. He was afraid they were going to sell it. So I reached out to the curator and I said, I don't know where this came from, but I hope you're not going to sell Sitting Bull's pipe. He said, no, we have no intention of doing that. And maybe that was his way of stopping that. Go ahead.
Yeah, it's interesting. Oh, okay. Oh, I think he wants to open up the forum to all alien life. So
Okay, all right. You know, it's interesting.
he's trying to prep me if it works out that I'm going there, it sounds great. I actually have clients that live there that I would love to see and hang out with. I do believe that there is they're wanting us to be open to all different types of alien.
Communication between, and correct me if I'm wrong, what he's saying is when we do this kind of work, we tend to talk to people that we knew because we can verify,
That's it.
but
Right.
also we can speak to animals. We've done that. And from
Trees.
this, sorry,
And trees.
and trees, and that idea that all beings, all entities have a certain amount of sentience and consciousness. I mean, we can't understand or fathom how that is, but that we, when we're talking about aliens, let's say ETs, or I'm trying to find a new word for that. Maybe there's something like a no-see-ums or.
Anything, but they're showing me the word foreign, like anything that feels foreign to us, right? That we can't,
Yeah.
and they're really showing us, like, if we can't see it, we tend not to believe it.
And we
And
also
so
tend to put it in a box.
even though that science is backing it up now, science is proving it otherwise.
Yes, and I was just reading about this woman in this scientist in Australia who has shown, proven, New York Times, National Geographic, that corn can call insects to come and protect it from other insects.
Remember you saying that.
So the idea that we are so unaware of what communication is, telepathy, of all of these things, and
He just showed me the fungus underneath the trees.
so,
Like,
and yeah, and this month's National Geographic, you probably haven't seen it, but it's all about fungi, and about mushrooms and how they have their own world. It's almost like there's humans, there's animals, and there's fungi, and it's a different species altogether. Anyway,
I
but
would, yeah.
go ahead. But he wants to open up the idea that people can communicate not only with nature and not only with beings off planet. Now it's
Right.
interesting because we had an interview, I was editing the book, interview with J. Allen Hynek, the guy who invented the term close encounters of the third kind, which I had liberally borrowed from him, was my science professor in grade school. And he had said how he had observed that the last contact in the desert, they had not talked about the afterlife at all. And he said, well, that's kind of silly now, isn't it? That's the way you put it. Like you guys didn't, because they're just focused on aliens and whatever, the science behind that and all of that stuff. And he was saying it's because it's all about consciousness,
Right.
And so is that what Sitting Bull is trying to say?
Sorry, my phone is blowing up. Apparently they saw me on a promo for Oprah because I was in the audience.
Oh.
And that's why I was laughing. And so my high school friends are like, "This is you? Did you meet Oprah?" And we did, which was great.
So, what were you saying? You were in the audience of Oprah show? How'd that work? What was that?
Audience of Oprah show. So my girlfriend got asked to be in the audience, and she's like, "Do you want to meet Oprah?" And so there was five of us girls that went. It was a lot of fun. She talked about how she lost weight, and
Oh,
the
it was that. I see. That show that she was doing. Okay. I was hoping that Oprah would spot you and say, why don't we talk about my previous lifetimes?
No, but I didn't meet her. It was
Well,
actually.
that's cool. But so that being said, back to you, Sitting Bull. I mean, it's not like, Sitting Bull's here. So what else do you want to talk about, sir?
He says, he goes, "That's it. Just wanted to give credence to the spirit world dealing with the
So
animals."
when talking to aliens, quote unquote, bear in
Just
mind. But let me ask you this, sir. There is this concept, we heard it recently, I'm trying to remember where, but that idea of that animals on the planet in some cases have incarnated on other planets. Is that correct?
that's correct. He just showed me like dragons,
So like a dragon on another planet in another realm in another universe might come here and incarnate as an animal. Is that correct? Okay.
right. But also that dragons are living within the, like, almost like the fairyland world, where the elves are, where I've got this image of five.
So they're living within our dimension, you're saying?
They're living, let me make sure I'm saying this right. Hold on. Yes, they're living in our dimension, within our dimension, but we can't see them.
Okay. Well, let me ask you this, Sitting Bull, if you
Like
don't mind. Go ahead.
we live as if we don't live within the same, we live in two different dimensions, but within the same space. It's very interesting.
Well, it's
Yeah.
like being on stage and we're completely aware of our props and costumes and our stage structure. And he's saying the theater is much bigger and there's other plays going on. But let me ask you this, sir. Do people ever interact, or is there anything, a crossover between you're not?
He just showed me. I'm talking
Oh, so like
about
a
her.
person that's here on stage is able to say, wait a second, there's another play going on. Is that correct?
He says a lot of people know it but don't think they can, so therefore they're capped. Like they can't, they can't jump if their mind says no. And
Sure.
so they're able to live their life out the way that they want to live it out. But then they showed me, for instance, and I just haven't put a cap on anything. I don't know what I'm capable of. I don't know. I haven't said no to being open to things that come through, right?
Yeah.
Even if I don't understand it, like number five. Which he thinks is just, he's just laughing about the whole situation.
Who
I'm like,
is Bull or Five?
Sitting Bull. Five doesn't laugh very much. Looks like a little grumpy old man,
But it's really funny. He's very dry wit. I mean, we asked him if he wanted to stand or sit down. He said the chair's too high because he's small. So that was hilarious. All right, I'm sorry, Sitting Bull. So, but let me ask you this, Sitting Bulls, because people will ask this question, even if it's not out loud. And that is, you're a great sage and you're somebody who understands nature in a very powerful, profound way. You did in life, and I'm sure you do now. How do people access you? What's the best way that somebody could, and give us a like a step by step, what a good way
He said,
to
planet, he goes, plant a tree. I'll be there. Like, plant a
plant
tree.
a tree. But while you're planting the tree, can I imagine that you're there?
Or he's showing me how I cut my flowers that were given. Like, I make my flowers last as long as they could. So I cut the ends off. He goes, it could be anything. Or being kind to an animal, that's injured. Or I know you asked for like a one, two,
No, I
three.
understand what he's saying. I correct me if I'm wrong. He's saying by
Oh,
accessing that information, you're accessing me. You don't have to
right.
think of me as a separate person.
That's it.
So you're like focused on, I mean, I have these videos on Instagram I watch of this guy who's always taking, seeds and turning them into plants and flowers and trees. And this guy's amazing. And it's like, oh, it's that easy to create, a thing that creates oxygen.
Yeah. He says we have lots of helpers, kind of like what I discussed when they showed me my dialogue with Jill. And it's just being aware, like we have lots of help. And then they showed me, with my dog Chloe, how there was so many people, just not my dad and my mom wasn't there yet, but my dad, I guess she was partially there.
Right, her higher self.
Yeah, to get Chloe. Sitting Bull says that there's a lot of people that come because Chloe wasn't just my dog. It was also other people's dogs or whatever it was before. And
Ah,
so all the
interesting.
life before, even though I can't prove that, but this is what he's saying is like Chloe belonged to other people before. So there's so many more people that we're not even aware of that are going to be there when we leave.
It's
Oh, man.
interesting when we talked to Robert Towne's dog, Hira, and he talked about being a horse in a previous lifetime for Robert. And so that would make sense because what people say is that we have a group of people help us to incarnate, siblings, parents, cousins. And so all of those people would still be attached in some way, tethered to who we are. So they were all there to greet us.
Yeah, and it was interesting. It's like this lifetime is like a recess.
What does
It's so like a like when you go to school as a little kid and you get recess, He's like, that's kind of, I don't know what he means. I think it's just the time
Well,
frame.
let's ask him. Do you mean
Well, like,
our current life on stage here is like a recess, or it?
it should be played like a recess, like having, he's just showing me kids having fun, like not caring and having, playing, being joyful, being excited to be out in the sun. He's like, he's just showing me how everybody's so white because they're inside and everybody's afraid of the sun. It's like, this is not how it is. And how vitamin D makes you happy.
You know, and you did spend a lot of your life that we're aware of. I mean, this one that we're talking about, let's say, of course, you probably have had many, but that idea of you spent so much time in nature and that it was like part of your journey and part of what you can observe and talk about. And I guess it's just to convince people to get out into the world, to breathe.
We're wasting a lot of time just in our minds at home or by not going out or not doing things. He's also like, be picky, be with people that you love. Don't.
So I'm going to ask you a question about Sioux philosophy. So there's the idea of the white buffalo. And I know I asked you this once before. I was like, have you run into the white buffalo? And you said at the time that you had seen many. So what is the essential spirit of a buffalo? Is that an ancient thing, or is that, I mean, how would you characterize it?
From what I'm picking up on, he's showing me the buffalo, like every part of the buffalo is used, it feels like, and that it reincarnate, like it keeps coming back, like it comes and gets used and then and leaves and comes back. And it shows about being strong and being fierce, but also just knowing its purpose.
Knowing its purpose. Wow.
Knowing its purpose. And we spend lifetimes trying to figure out our own purpose,
That's
right?
right. Humans don't. We
Or
don't have
being
a clue.
our purpose is being us. Like they're just like, your purpose is you with direction, hopefully. But sometimes it's without direction. Sometimes you're meant to be like the afterlife of Billy. They showed me the afterlife of Billy Fingers, where he was meant to come here and,
Grew up. Yeah.
just party it up and then leave.
Sure. And so everybody's play is just a little bit different depending upon how it was designed and who you planned it out with. Wow, that's pretty unusual. Sitting Bull, we're going to lose Jennifer in a few seconds, but is there anything you want to say to our audience and just by way of encouragement or how to stay in touch with nature?
He says gift giving. If you want to gift give, like it's interesting. He's like gift giving. He's showing me like looking out at, let's say, some flowers where there's some bees. Even the flowers can pick up your intention and your vibe and whether you're happy or not, which also extends those lives. Like just by the mere presence of being happiness, like being happy and being joyful. Like, they obviously flowers go towards the sunlight. If you don't have them by the sun, like they go towards the sunlight just naturally. Humans should do the same. He's just like, we can learn so much from just being and not wanting or taking or whatever it is. Just being love gives off the best effervescent. Like he's showing me not radiation, but energy.
Energy. All right, I have one last question for Luana, if I could. Thank you, Sitting Bull. Yesterday, I had a meeting with somebody where we did a guided meditation, and a friend of ours showed up, Amelia, and I asked her a question, and she showed us a person. Was that accurate?
I don't know. Was there? I mean, she didn't show you Chuck Groden. He keeps popping in.
Oh, Chuck. Hi, Chuck. How are you?
He's doing great. He's just observing. But I picked it. Okay, hold on. Yes, it was correct, but you didn't believe it.
I was asking her about the project that I've been talking about for so long, and she gave us a person, to think about, to consider, being a part of the project. And I thought, wow, that's really unusual, because the person I was talking to had no clue that she could even possibly, have Amelia speak to her. And I
Right.
asked Amelia, is this friend of mine, like, is she ready to go to help me make this thing? And she said Amelia's standing up and has her hands on her hips, like challenging her.
I'm ready.
Like, are you ready? You think you're
Yeah.
ready? It was beautiful. Anyway,
Yeah.
I know
I'm
you got to go. Jennifer, thank you so much for your gifts, and thank you, Setting Ball. And thank you, Luana, for showing up. And I mean, how cool was that?
like, why did you have to wrestle? And she was just showing me fighting a bull, like just trying to, she
Just
was.
put you in that metaphor, Sitting Bull. Okay, very good. And a lot of people who tune in are like, this is total Sitting Bull. Just kidding. All right, very good. Tatanka Ayotake, thank you. Jennifer, thank you. And for those tuning in and still driving on the road, we thank you for tuning in.
Thank you. All right, have a great week.
Have a great week. Love you.
Bye.
This has been Hacking the Afterlife Podcast with Jennifer Shaffer. For more information, jenniferschaefer.com, martinizone.com, or richmartini.com. Hacking the Afterlife documentary is available on Amazon Prime.